This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. A Social History of Hebrew. Its Origins Through the Rabbinic Period. William M. Schniedewind. The Anchor Yale Bible Reference Library. Yale University Press, New Haven and London. Anchor Yale Bible and the Anchor Yale logo are registered trademarks of Yale University. Published with assistance from the foundation established in memory of Amasa Stone Mather of the class of 1907, Yale College. Copyright 2013 by Yale University. All rights reserved. This book may not be reproduced in whole or in part, including illustrations in any form, beyond that copying permitted by Sections 107 and 108 of the U.S. Copyright Law, and except by reviewers for the public press, without written permission from the publishers. Yale University Press books may be purchased in quantity for educational, business, or promotional use. For information, please email sales.press@yale.edu, U.S. office, or sales@yaleup.co.uk, U.K. office. Senin Saban type by Nugent, North America. Printed in the United States of America. Library of Congress cataloging and publication data. Schniedewind, William M. A Social History of Hebrew, Its Origins Through the Rabbinic Period, William M. Schniedewind. Pages CM. The Anchor Yale Bible Reference Library. Includes bibliographical references and index. ISBN 978-0-300-17668-1 Cloth ALK, paper. 1. Hebrew Language History. 2. Hebrew Language Post-Biblical History. I-Title. PJ 4545, S434 2013. 492.409, DC 23. 2,013,011,898. A catalog record for this book is available from the British Library. This paper meets the requirements of ANSI, NISO Z39.48-1992, Permanence of Paper. 10987654321. To Norma Kershaw for her interest, enthusiasm, and support in many ways. Contents. Preface. List of abbreviations. 1. Language, Land and People, Toward the History of Classical Hebrew. 2. The Origins of Hebrew, In Search of the Holy Tongue. 3. Early Hebrew Writing. 4. Linguistic Nationalism and the Emergence of Hebrew. 5. The Democratization of Hebrew. 6. Hebrew in Exile. 7. Hebrew under Imperialism. 8. Hebrew in the Hellenistic World. 9. The End and the Beginning of Hebrew. 10. Epilogue. Notes. Bibliography. Index. Preface. This book has had a long journey to its destination. It has been assisted along the way by many people, was sidetracked by detours, and met fellow travelers. The journey is an important preamble for understanding its final destination. I wish to begin by thanking my first teachers in Hebrew and Semitic languages. The fact that the writer of this book began studying both modern and ancient Hebrew at the same time in the land of Israel, in Jerusalem, and on Mount Zion is a critical bit of background information about this book. My first biblical teachers were Jerome Lund, William Williams, and Weston Fields at the American Institute of Holy Land Studies, now known as Jerusalem University College. I remember with especial fondness the courses by Chaim Rabin, who taught me comparative Semitics and served as an advisor on my MA thesis. He is still the best language teacher that I ever had, and was far ahead of his time in the social approach to studying ancient Hebrew. I am forever grateful for the rigor in Hebrew required for my doctoral studies at Brandeis University. I especially wish to thank Stephen Geller, Avi Hurwitz, and Daniel Savan, who taught me in various courses in Hebrew, Aramaic epigraphy, and Northwest Semitics. I also remember with fondness the late Anson Rainey, who was first my teacher and later my friend, and who bore with me as I learned about the Hebrew verbal system and Amarna Canaanite. The research for this book began in earnest after I took up my position at UCLA in 1994, and later in 1996 when I took a sabbatical in Jerusalem as a visiting scholar at the Hebrew University working on Northern Hebrew. UCLA has been a rich environment to study languages, beginning with my first chair, then colleague and friend Antonio Loprano. I wish to thank my colleagues who have contributed in small and large ways to this book, including Carol Bacos, Ron and Bustan, Aaron Burke, Yako Dielman, Raheem Shagan, and Yonah Sabar. I am grateful for Sarah Sheckman, who became a colleague and also a careful reviewer. I have been particularly fortunate while working on this book to have encountered some of the finest scholars of linguistic anthropology at UCLA, including Alessandro Durante and Paul Croscritti. UCLA has been a wonderful place to work, and I am forever grateful for my colleagues who have enriched my scholarly horizons. Perhaps one of the understated joys of scholarship is the fellow travelers that you meet along the journey. I have particularly profited from David Carr, Frank Pollock, and Seth Sanders, whom I met along the way to completing this book. Perhaps most influential are my students, especially Matt Siriano, Jeremy Smoke, Cale Johnson, Moise Isaac, Melissa Ramos, and Alice Mandel, who served as research assistants and dialogue partners along the way. I've learned perhaps more from them than I was able to teach them, and I and the book are both better for all my students and their contributions. One can never have enough careful readers, and I am particularly thankful to John Collins for his incisive reading of the manuscript and his support for the project. I apologize to him for being too thick or dull to take all of his advice. I am also grateful for the support of Norma Kershaw, who endowed my chair at UCLA and who has been a faithful supporter of my research and of the field of ancient Eastern Mediterranean studies. This book has met with considerable detours and obstacles. The first obstacle was my appointment as chair of the Department of Near Eastern Languages and Cultures in 2000. Administrative duties have certainly waylaid this book. In the course of writing, I also had the idea of writing a more general work on the role of writing in the formation of the Bible, which was published as How the Bible Became a Book, The Textualization of Ancient Israel, in 2004. Although I began that book after I began this one, I completed How the Bible Became a Book first. Nevertheless, I think it was a useful detour. I was finally able to complete the initial manuscript for this book during a 3-year hiatus from serving as department chair from 2007 to 2010. I have endeavored to make this book accessible to a wide range of readers. Just as I have profited from interactions with a variety of scholars outside of historical Hebrew linguistics, I hope this book will be of interest to a wide variety of people with interest in language and Jewish history. In that respect, I have generally used Romanized Hebrew transcriptions rather than the modern Hebrew alphabet. I have also preferred to use simplified transcriptions of the ancient Hebrew, that is, without the later Masoretic vowels, except in cases where the later vocalizations serve to illustrate or advance the argument. In general, the translations of the Bible are my own. That said, I give translations that are close to standard scholarly ones, like the New Revised Standard or the New Jewish Publication Society versions. Likewise, I give my own translations of ancient inscriptions, unless otherwise indicated. Finally, while working on this book, I have also witnessed the growth of my two daughters from toddlers to college age. I hope that I have written something that is worthy of their reading. Though last, it is certainly not least that I acknowledge my patient wife, who has immeasurably enriched not only this book, but my life. Abbreviations. Abed. Anchor Bible Dictionary, edited by D.N. Friedman. 6 vols. New York, Doubleday, 1992. ABH. Archaic Biblical Hebrew. ABL. Assyrian and Babylonian Letters, edited by R. Harper. Chicago, University of Chicago Press, 1914. B. Babylonian Talmud. CAD. Chicago Assyrian Dictionary, edited by M. Roth. Chicago, Oriental Institute of the University of Chicago, 1956-2006. CUS. Context of Scripture, edited by W. Hullo and K. L. Younger. 3 vols. Leiden, Brill 2003. Ea. El Amarna. See the Amarna Letters, edited by W. Moran. Baltimore, Maryland, Johns Hopkins University, 2000. A. Epigraphic Hebrew. M. Encyclopedia Migrat. Jerusalem, Bialik, 1965-1988. Enschud. Encyclopedia Judaica. 16 vols. Philadelphia, Coronet, 1972. IH. Israelian Hebrew. KTU. Heilschrift Texte aus Ugarit, edited by M. Dietrich, O. Loretz, and J. San Martin. Translated as the cuneiform alphabetic texts from Ugarit, Ross Ibn Hani, and other places. 2nd ed. Munster, Germany, Ugarit Verlag, 1995. LBH. Late Biblical Hebrew. M. Mishnah. MH. Mishnaic Hebrew. Mount. Masoretic Text. Pru. Le Palais Royal d'Ugarit, edited by C. Varolo, J. Nugiral, and C. Schaefer. Mission Archéologique de Ross Chamra. Paris, Imprimerie Nationale, 1955-1970. Q. Qumran Cave. QH. Qumran Hebrew. RH. Rabbinic Hebrew. RH1. Tanaitic Hebrew or Early Rabbinic Hebrew. RH2. Amoric Hebrew or Late Rabbinic Hebrew. SA. State Archives of Assyria. Institute for Asian and African Studies, University of Helsinki, Finland, 1987. SBH. Standard Biblical Hebrew. T. Tosefta. Y. Talmud Yerushalmi. A Social History of Hebrew. 1. Language, Land and People, Toward the History of Classical Hebrew. These are the descendants of Shem according to their families, their languages, their lands, and their nations. Genesis chapter 10 verse 31. As I finish this book, I recall a public lecture I attended one evening at a prestigious private university. After the lecture, a few students gathered around an eminent scholar of Semitic languages who casually commented, "I am only interested in the languages, not the people who spoke them." I was a young graduate student back then, and I no longer recall either the lecture or the exact topic of the conversation that prompted the remark. But I still remember those words and my sense of stunned amazement. I had thought that the purpose of studying obscure ancient languages was to understand the people, their societies, and their cultures. Little did I know that I would eventually be writing this book arguing for a close relationship between the early history of the Jewish people and the Hebrew language. This book contends that language does not stand apart from the social history of its people. Language and writing are part of a cultural system, and the early history of the Hebrew language is closely tied to the early history of the Jewish people. Of course, my sense of amazement about the separation between the study of languages and the people who speak them was really a function of my own ignorance. The well-known linguistic anthropologist Alessandro Durante points out that this distinction is typical of the formal approach to linguistic analysis. In general, phonologists, morphologists, and syntacticians are more interested in the relationship among different elements of the linguistic system, sounds, parts of words, phrases, and sentences, than in the relationship between such elements and the world out there that such a system is meant to represent. This disjunction between languages and their speakers takes the study of language out of context. As Durante observes, it is hence a very abstract and removed Homo sapiens that is being studied by most formal grammarians, not the kids in a Philadelphia neighborhood or the orators of Ghana. Likewise, it has often been a disembodied Hebrew that scholars have studied, as if the history of the Hebrew language were somehow unrelated to the social history of the prophets and poets, scribes and priests who penned the ancient Hebrew language. This book has two propositions that guide it and give it a unique perspective on the history of the Hebrew language. First, it begins with the premise that the ancient Hebrew language was part of the social fabric of the people living in the ancient Eastern Mediterranean. This hardly seems like a revolutionary statement. Language is constrained by its role as a communication device. We do not talk to ourselves, at least we are not supposed to. A language is conditioned by the movements of social life, the vicissitudes of war and peace, the inroads of nationalism and imperialism, the upheavals of urbanization and immigration, and the ebb and flow of economic tides. As such, the history of a language mirrors the history of the people who speak it, or, in our present case, the people who wrote our texts. Languages take their cues from the social life of peoples and nations. As Edward Sapper put it, the history of language and the history of culture move along parallel lines. They move along parallel lines because they are part of the same cultural system. The history of Hebrew is no exception. Classical Hebrew was intimately connected to the life of the people. The ancient Hebrew language was both socially conditioned and socially constrained. Second, this book is shaped by the linguistics of writing, that is, the record of Hebrew in textual artifacts, rather than by the linguistics of speech, that is, the piecing together of the phonology of ancient Hebrew speakers. The study of Semitic languages, including Hebrew, has had an extraordinary focus on phonology, in spite of the problematic relationship between writing and speech, as well as the inability to speak with native informants, except perhaps in a seance, as Saul and the Witch of Endor did with Samuel. Thus, this book focuses on the early history of Hebrew as a written language. The scope of this book. The scope of this book is limited in a variety of ways. First of all, it focuses upon the history of ancient Hebrew as a writing system. The early history of the Hebrew language is, in some respects, the history of a writing system. As such, it is interested in questions that arise from the linguistics of textual artifacts, such as spelling, script schools, and language standardization. It also tackles the problem of the relationship of writing to speech, while discussing the formidable problems encountered when trying to relate written artifacts to vernacular language. We can only guess how ancient Hebrew actually sounded, and scholars have tended to have rather romantic notions about the relationship between ancient writing systems and the sounds of these ancient languages. As the linguist Florian Kulmus has pointed out, all phonographic writing systems, however refined and concerned with language-specific phonetic detail, omit great numbers of phonetic distinctions. This book, then, will focus on the changes in the writing system and not on the phonetics of Hebrew. At the same time, this book is concerned with the history of Hebrew as a vernacular. To be sure, there is no direct evidence for vernacular Hebrew. Obviously, there are no live informants. The written text is only indirect evidence for spoken Hebrew. But we can reconstruct aspects of the social life of the ancient Israelites who spoke Hebrew, what linguistic anthropologists call the speech community. Observations about the history of the speech community can lend great insight to the social history of the language, even if they do not tell us the exact pronunciation of the letter. Is it shush or s or some variant thereof, or exactly when the Canaanite shift, that is, a greater than o, took place? This book will adapt the linguistic idea of the speech community to the type of evidence that we have, namely, written texts that were generated by a scribal community. The history of early Hebrew thus must be shaped first of all by understanding the history of the Hebrew scribal community, or communities, and secondarily by the history of the Hebrew speech community. It should now be clear that this book will not be a traditional history of the Hebrew language. That is, this is not a history of the Hebrew language focusing primarily on the traditional linguistic categories of speech, for example, phonology, morphology. That has been done before, most recently by Angel Scenes Badios, by Murray Hanna's label, and by E.Y. Kutcher's important, though incomplete, History of the Hebrew Language. Several older works also cover aspects of the history of Hebrew. Bauer and Leander, Sperber, and several others have contributed historical grammars of Biblical Hebrew. Those looking for a more complete description of phonetic and morphological developments in the Hebrew language must consult these other works. The present work aims more at understanding the relationship between the social life of the people in Canaan and the evolution of the Hebrew language. My approach is perhaps most influenced by my teacher Chaim Rabin. In his brief but brilliant little book A Short History of the Hebrew Language, he describes the sociology of the Hebrew language, introducing us to the interplay between the Hebrew language and the history of the Jewish people. Rabin's work is now out of print and out of date, and it is so brief that it only tantalizes. There have been many attempts to popularize the history of the Hebrew language for a more general audience. The best examples of this are Edward Horowitz's old classic, How the Hebrew Language Grew, and Joel Hoffman's more recent book in the beginning, A Short History of the Hebrew Language. Yet, these works do not offer the broad historical survey of the Hebrew language as part of a cultural system, which I seek to reconstruct here. Chronologically, this book is a social history of Hebrew from its emergence as a language in ancient Canaan until its disappearance as a regularly spoken language in Roman Palestine in about 200 CE. Rabbinic Hebrew, RH, is the last gasp of Hebrew as a living language in Palestine. Though Hebrew itself had ceased to be spoken by 200 CE, the Mishnah was codified about 230 CE. The term Mishnaic Hebrew, MH, is sometimes used as an alternative to Rabbinic Hebrew, but this term also has its deficiencies. Usually Mishnaic Hebrew privileges the Mishnah, even though the corpus of early rabbinic texts is much larger. Furthermore, it focuses on textual artifacts rather than the cultural context with which I am trying to connect the Hebrew language. Indeed, scholars have described the two stages of rabbinic Hebrew, that is, RH1 and RH2, as comprising an earlier period, RH1, or Tanaitic Hebrew, continuing through the 2nd century CE when Hebrew was still regularly spoken, and a later period, RH2, or Amoric Hebrew, at which stage Hebrew was essentially a literary language. Judging by the Bar Kokhba letters, 132-135 CE, it would seem that the daily use of spoken Hebrew was already in sharp decline during the first centuries of the Common Era. Ultimately, Hebrew was uprooted from Palestine and accompanied the Jewish people throughout their wanderings until it found its way back to the Promised Land in the late 19th century CE. As Scenes Badia's recognized, medieval Hebrew, as this stage is broadly termed, is much less clearly defined than our earlier stages. This results from medieval Hebrew's eclectic dependence on various earlier stages of the language, the use of Hebrew primarily as a literary language, and the great variety of geographic and historical settings in which Hebrew was employed, for example, France, Spain, North Africa, Persia. These later stages in the social history of Hebrew have already been the subject of some sociolinguistic scrutiny and are beyond the scope of the present work. And as much as this book is concerned with the nexus between language, land, and people, it has struggled with terminology. The terms that we use, like Israel or Palestine, are often loaded with modern political or religious baggage that is really outside the scope and interests of this book. I endeavor to use terms apolitically. One particularly interesting problem is the word for people. What shall we call the people living in Judah, Yehud, Palestine from the Iron Age through the Roman period? There is only one Hebrew term, YHWDY, Yehudi, which might be translated as Yehudite, Judean, or Jew, reflecting the different eras of the people in the land. Typically, scholars might use the term Jew to refer to the Jewish people after the Bar Kokhba revolt, that is, after 135 CE. Some scholars might extend the use of the term to the people in the late Second Temple period, but would resist using Jew to refer to the Iron Age people living in and around Jerusalem. The distinctions make some historical sense, but they do not accord with the fact that there is just one Hebrew term. Moreover, one might question what makes the use of the term Jew acceptable for both 200 CE and 2000 CE, but not for 200 CE and 200 BCE. Are Jews in 2000 and 200 CE more similar than in 200 CE and 200 BCE? Moreover, the use of the same term by the ancient speech community created a sense of identity between the ancient Jews living in the Iron Age, the Jews living in the Second Temple period, and the Jews of late antiquity. A social anthropologist might even call this sense of identity fictive kinship, but it is nevertheless reinforced by language and metalanguage, that is, the use of one Hebrew term, YHWDY, Yehudi. For the purposes of this book, I wish to emphasize the linguistic connection between YHWDY, YHWDH, and YHWDYT, that is, the terms used for people, land, and language. It is not a coincidence that the linguistic nexus between people and language is broken after the Bar Kokhba revolt, when the Jews no longer lived in Judea, and began using the term Brit, Hebrew, to refer to their language. In other words, the metalanguage for Hebrew closely follows the social history. I call the language discussed in this book Classical Hebrew. This is a much broader description than Biblical Hebrew, which refers to the Hebrew represented in biblical texts. By Classical Hebrew, I mean to refer to the Hebrew used during the classical period of history in Canaan, from the origins of the Jewish people until the dispersions of the early centuries of the Common Era. Thus, Classical Hebrew subsumes several other Hebrew dialects, including Biblical Hebrew, Qumran Hebrew, Epigraphic Hebrew, and Early Rabbinic Hebrew. I will also utilize the standard chronological distinction within Biblical Hebrew, namely, Archaic Biblical Hebrew, ABH, Standard Biblical Hebrew, SBH, and Late Biblical Hebrew, LBH. The use of classical to refer to the entire scope of written Hebrew from Biblical through Rabbinic Hebrew certainly broadens Classical Hebrew out of its traditional constraints. I think, however, that it is important to recognize the aspects of continuity in spoken and written Hebrew over this time span, even though the Babylonian exile resulted in a major disjunction in the scribal institutions that produced Hebrew texts, as well as the speech community that used Hebrew in ancient Judah. It is the continuity of Hebrew as a spoken and evolving language, in spite of the social and demographic disjunctions resulting from the Babylonian invasions and deportations, that justifies a more inclusive definition of Classical Hebrew. Indeed, a broader definition of Classical Hebrew has already been employed, for example, by the Dictionary of Classical Hebrew. This dictionary, however, does not include Rabbinic Hebrew, apparently for practical considerations. Its editor nevertheless boasts that his dictionary does not restrict itself to, or privilege in any way, those ancient Hebrew texts found in the Bible. Although a broader definition of Classical Hebrew is commendable, the exclusion of the Mishnaic texts is given no linguistic rationale. The definition of Classical Hebrew as spanning the period when Hebrew was a living, spoken language in a defined locale is a defensible linguistic definition that must include the first stage of Rabbinic Hebrew. More specifically, I will narrow the geographic region of this social history of Hebrew to the region of Judah, Yehud, Palestine. These three terms, Judah, Yehud, and Palestine, are the historical terms used in antiquity by the Jews themselves, the Persians, and the Romans for the territory centered around Jerusalem. The use of Classical Hebrew arises in the Kingdom of Judah at the end of the second millennium BCE and declines in the province of Roman Palestina, Palestine, by 200 CE. It is worth reflecting on the question of who defines the scope of a language. How are languages classified and categorized? Languages are usually defined by politics, historical circumstance, or deeply held ideologies. Thus, a language like Chinese is defined as one language by politics, as well as a unifying script that is promulgated by a government, in spite of the fact that the dialects of Mandarin and Cantonese are mutually unintelligible. On the other hand, a language like Serbo-Croatian has been redefined as two languages, Serbian and Croatian, as a result of historical and political events. One may ask whether Flemish and Dutch are one language or two. Here, it is important to recognize that all language classification is shaped by linguistic ideologies. For example, the description of Chinese as one language with several dialects, and of Norwegian, Danish, and Swedish as three languages is more a reflex of nationalism and borders than the conclusion of descriptive linguistics. As the sociolinguists Judith Irvine and Susan Gall observe, linguistic ideologies are held not only by the immediate participants in a local sociolinguistic system. They are also held by other observers, such as the linguists and ethnographers who have mapped the boundaries of languages and peoples and provided descriptive accounts of them. We return now to our specific topic, who has defined Classical Hebrew as it has been understood in scholarship. Classical Hebrew has usually been synonymous with Biblical Hebrew. This narrow definition of Classical Hebrew has emerged, at least in part, as a result of the work of Christian theologians who organized the rubric of Classical Hebrew according to the classical period of Jewish history as they defined it. Thus, Classical Hebrew has usually excluded Rabbinic or Mishnaic Hebrew, which belonged to the next era of history, the period after Christianity's decisive break with Judaism. Many medieval Jewish grammarians, in contrast, emphasized the continuity of the Hebrew language. No doubt this reflected, in part, the Jewish sense of historical continuity that is evident from ancient times. Consider, for example, a central social institution like the Passover commemoration or the oral tradition, see Exod 13:14 Abbot 1:1. Even though Hebrew itself ceased to be spoken as an everyday language by sometime in the 3rd or 4th century CE, Hebrew continued to be used as the language of sacred literature and even served as a trade language among Jews throughout the diaspora. To be fair, the categories of classical and rabbinic Hebrew were also shaped by the configuration of our sources. Until relatively recently, the main corpora of ancient Hebrew literature were the Hebrew Bible or Old Testament and rabbinic literature, with a considerable chronological gap between them. The discovery of a growing corpus of ancient Hebrew inscriptions, as well as the Dead Sea Scrolls, now invites us to redefine classical Hebrew in much broader terms. Finally, it should be noted that the term Hebrew, Ibrit, itself is not a biblical term for the Hebrew language. Although we now call the language of ancient Israel and Judah Hebrew, this term first appears for the language in the Mishnah, M. 9-6-8, M. Yadayim 4-5, which was edited around 230 CE. That is, the metalinguistic term Hebrew emerged precisely when the speech community in Palestine was disappearing. Furthermore, it appeared when the traditional linguistic identification of people, language, and land had disappeared with the changed socio-political situation of the Jewish community. This new term also formally recognized the difference between Hebrew and Aramaic as two Jewish languages, in contrast to the New Testament's use of the Greek word hebristhi, hebristhi, to refer to the vernacular Jewish language, without making clear whether this term refers to Hebrew or Aramaic. The term for the Hebrew language that would have been used by the prophet Isaiah in 700 BCE or the priest Ezra in 400 BCE is Yehudite, Yehudit, which is derived from the word for the territory of Judah, Yehuda, and is also generally used for the ethnic group Judean, Jew, Yehudi, in post-exilic biblical literature, Qumran literature, and rabbinic literature. It is quite typical of languages to be called after territories and ethnicities, thus German and Germany, English and England, or Chinese and China. This fact actually highlights changes in the Hebrew language as it related to Jewish identity in different periods. The Jews, Judeans who lived in Judah, Judea always spoke the Judean, Jewish language. It is only when the Jews were expelled from Judea that the Judean language ceased to be a living vernacular. In fact, it is only at this time that the Jewish language became Hebrew. When the terminology for the language of the Jews is separated from that of the territory, it marks a profound shift in the history of the language itself. For the purposes of this book, I shall use the conventional and later term Hebrew. In order to make this book more useful as a reference work to a variety of readers, I have attempted to compile short descriptions of the salient features of the various stages and dialects of written Hebrew. At the end of chapters 2-5 and 7-9, I provide a brief description of early West Semitic, Archaic Biblical Hebrew, ABH, Israelian Hebrew, IH, Epigraphic Hebrew, A, Standard Biblical Hebrew, SBH, Late Biblical Hebrew, LBH, Qumran Hebrew, QH, and Early Rabbinic Hebrew, RH1. The Linguistics of Writing Systems, Classical Hebrew. To further answer our question of what constitutes classical Hebrew, we should point to the exact object of our study, namely textual artifacts. The ancient Hebrew language is embodied in a series of texts. Thus, whereas the ancient Hebrew language, as we know it, is a corpus of written texts, linguistics as a discipline has been fundamentally the study of speech. The question of the relationship between textual artifacts and speech raises the important question of linguistic consciousness. Namely, to what extent did ancient Judeans identify their vernacular with written texts? Or, put differently, would the term Judahite, which was used for the spoken language, also have referred to the writing system? These questions become even more interesting when we realize the limited nature of literacy in antiquity. Although we tend to equate writing with language, this is not an axiomatic connection. Thus, by posing the seemingly innocent question, "What is classical Hebrew?" we also raise not only the issue of the intrinsic relationship between writing and speech, but also the specific question about the relationship between the Hebrew writing system and the ancient speech community. Written artifacts are the products of a scribal community, not a speech community. No writing system duplicates speech, and the gap between writing and speech varies from language to language. A strictly phonemic writing system would be a writing system with a one-to-one relationship between graphemes, that is, letters, and phonemes, that is, sounds. Such writing systems are usually described as alphabetic writing. Languages like Spanish and Finnish have quite close relationships between graphemes and phonemes. English, on the other hand, exhibits a high degree of complexity in the relationship between graphemes and phonemes. Modern Hebrew lies somewhere between these extremes. There are no pure phonemic writing systems, and classical Hebrew is no exception. And it is not simply that writing imperfectly records speech. As Saussure notably pointed out, language and writing are two distinct systems of signs. Florian Kulmas goes further in his writing systems, an introduction to their linguistic analysis, stating that writing follows its own logic, which is not that of speech. In addition to the problematic relationship between writing and speech, there is also often an intentional distinction between certain aspects of writing systems and speech. The term diglossia is often used to describe the tension between writing conventions and speech. We know some of the ways in which classical Hebrew, as a writing system, was an imprecise representation of the phonemes of speech. Most notably, classical Hebrew writing originally lacked vowel letters, and for this reason it has been labeled an abjad, that is, an alphabetic writing system that generally represents only consonants. Hebrew did begin to incorporate some vowels by the 8th century BCE, but a systematic representation of vowels did not develop until the 6th or 7th century CE. In addition, we know that several Hebrew letters serve for multiple phonemes such as for SS, for HH, and for G. Given that the Proto-Canaanite alphabetic inscriptions have a much richer inventory of graphemes, Ugaritic has 28 consonantal graphemes, and the Sarabit El-Khanum and Wadi El-Hol inscriptions suggest at least 44 graphemes, we cannot be certain about the precise degree to which the 22-letter classical Hebrew alphabet represents its consonantal phonemes. For example, how is the Hebrew word arz, land, pronounced in antiquity? We know that Arabic preserves the spelling rod, and ancient Aramaic first wrote the word as rq, then later as r. To what degree were hypothetical Proto-Semitic phonemes like d preserved in the speech of ancient Israelites? Were they preserved in some places and not others? The Shibboleth story in Judges chapter 12 verses 5 to 6 is instructive here. Then the Gileadites took the fords of the Jordan against the Ephraimites. Whenever one of the fugitives of Ephraim said, "Let me go over," the men of Gilead would say to him, "Are you an Ephraimite?" When he said, "No," they said to him, "Then say Shibboleth," and he said, "Sibboleth," for he could not pronounce it right. Then they seized him and killed him at the fords of the Jordan. 42,000 of the Ephraimites fell at that time. The difference here between Shibboleth and Sibboleth is a graphemic convention in the writing of the story, but scholars have only guesses about the pronunciations of this word. The Shibboleth-Sibboleth story provides just a hint of the dialectal variation that must have existed and the limits of writing systems for conveying the precise nature of these differences. Without direct evidence from native speakers, we should be quite sanguine about reconstructing the phonology of ancient Hebrew. The problem of reconstructing phonology is not simply the lack of native informants for ancient Hebrew, but also the inadequacy of the written sources. Edward Ollendorf, for example, questioned the adequacy of the Bible as a source for Hebrew in his classic essay, "Is Biblical Hebrew a Language?" Ollendorf began his critique by pointing out that the standard linguistic definition of language deals with sound, not text. Without native speakers, biblical Hebrew has no sounds. Ultimately, Ollendorf was more consumed by the inadequacy of the biblical Hebrew lexicon, namely, the fact that its limited vocabulary would not be adequate to serve as the basis for the ordinary day-to-day requirements of a normal speech community. The Hebrew Bible, for example, contains between 7,000 and 8,000 distinct words, as compared to a typical modern Hebrew dictionary, which contains upward of 40,000 words. But the problem is more than simply a reflex of the limited corpus of biblical Hebrew. Writing is simply not a surrogate for speech. Thus, we must study the linguistics of a writing system, which has its own rules and logic quite apart from speech. Spelling itself is not usually an attempt at graphic transcription of speech. Spelling might be defined as the phonographic segmentation of language, yet alphabetic spelling is problematic from a linguistic perspective. It has been pointed out, for example, that illiterate adults find it difficult to divide the stream of speech into segments. As a result, phonologists have increasingly moved away from the idea that the alphabet represents segments of speech because individual letters are difficult to discern in speech. Moreover, although speech may be represented as sequences of letters on an abstract level, letters never constitute a precise representation of speech. Compounding the problem of the relationship between speech and writing is the fact that spelling is a social convention. As Florian Kuhlmes has observed, as a general rule, spelling conventions, once established, are more resistant to change than speech, which is another way of saying that written words tend to have an autonomous existence and phonetic interpretations are adjusted. Conventional ways of spelling often override their straightforward phonetic reading. In a parody often attributed to Mark Twain, spelling has little to do with transcription and everything to do with convention. The author suggested some logical spelling reforms for English. For example, in year one, that useless letter C would be dropped to be replaced either by K or S, and likewise X would no longer be part of the alphabet. The only Ks in which C would be retained would be the CH formation, which will be dealt with later. Year 2 might reform W spelling, so that which and one would take the same consonant, while year 3 might well abolish Y, replacing it with I, and higher 4 might fix the G, J anomaly once and for all. Generally then, the improvement would continue IEAR by IEAR, with higher 5 doing all Y with useless double consonants, and IERS 6 to 12 or so modifying vowels, and the rhyming voiced and unvoiced consonants. By IR 15 or SU, it would finally be possible to make IUSOVT redundant letters C, Y, and X, By now just a memory in the man's oviel doderes, to replace ch, shish, and th respectively. Finally, xen, aafte sam 20 years ov orthographical reform, why would hev illogical, coherent spelling in iusx rewad z English spiking world. English in particular is replete with irregularities and historical spellings, but this parody does highlight the fact that spelling is not transcription of speech. Spelling can also have an ideological component. As an example, it is worth recalling Noah Webster's justification for spelling reform in American English in 1789. As an independent nation, our honor requires us to have a system of our own in language as well as government. Somehow the spelling honor, as against the British honor, would help achieve a sense of national identity. Ironically, the differences in American and British spelling of words like center, center or color tell us very little about the differences in pronunciation. We can spell words like schedule or about exactly the same, but pronounce them quite differently. Like spelling, script choice is also motivated by underlying ideologies. Such ideological undercurrents can already be inferred in ancient Ugarit, ca. 1200 BCE, where two writing systems, alphabetic cuneiform and standard cuneiform, are used and distinguish between national literature in correspondence and international matters. Another obvious example is the use of Paleo-Hebrew script on the coins used by fledgling Jewish kingdoms like the Hasmoneans and Bar Kokhba, as well as the modern state of Israel. When they established new and independent polities, they were careful to employ the Paleo-Hebrew script on the coins minted by the new government, even though the script was hopelessly anachronistic. Orthography can also be a means of indicating language choice and group identity. Several scholars have discussed the foreign factor in the Hebrew Bible, that is, the tendency of biblical authors to introduce linguistic variation to indicate a foreign speaker or setting. Scholars have noted a number of interesting examples of this phenomenon. Perhaps the most obvious is the use of an Aramaic sentence in Genesis chapter 31 verse 47, where Laban, who is described as an Aramean and who lives in northern Syria, speaks one short sentence in Aramaic. Another notable example of this phenomenon is the word MLH, word, in the book of Job. The story is set in the East, and scholars have long noted the use of many linguistic elements colored with Aramaic and even Arabian to indicate the foreign nature of the characters. Perhaps the most telling example, however, is the variety of forms of the word MLH, word, which itself is a metalinguistic term. In the Book of Job, the word is interchangeably spelled with its Aramaic form lin, words, 13 times, and its SBH form MLYM, words, 10 times. More telling, however, is the fact that this metalinguistic term is the only word in the entire book that interchanges between the Aramaic affirmative, YN, and the Hebrew affirmative, YM. The scribes were thus quite aware of language and used it intentionally to indicate the identity of the characters in the narrative. The field of linguistics has, in fact, emphasized speech as the proper focus for the study of language. One of Leonard Bloomfield's students went so far as to say that language is basically speech, and writing is of no theoretical interest. The reason for the virtual exclusion of writing from the field of linguistics is fundamentally biological. From a biological viewpoint, speech is perceived as natural, whereas writing is contrived. Speech, not writing, is one of the things that separate man from the animals. Speech exists in all human societies and appeared long before writing. For this reason, the French critic Jacques Derrida called writing the wandering outcast that has haunted the field of linguistics, even as the field tries to ignore it. However, in the study of ancient Hebrew, we cannot ignore the written aspect of language. Writing is not a simple correlate of language. The social setting for learning to read and write is formal. This social context is not conducive to radical changes, nor does it necessitate a close correspondence between writing and speech. In the words of Leonard Bloomfield, the inadequacy of the actual writing systems is due largely to the conservatism of the people who write. Writing is portrayed as an inadequate, or inaccurate reflection of language. The conventions of writing often remain unchanged even after speech forms have undergone profound linguistic changes. As a result, writing is much more than a complement to speech. It is socially defined by scribal training. For example, the colloquial future in English is going to, as in, I'm going to go on vacation next week, yet this colloquial future tense is not considered correct for formal written correspondence. Likewise, spelling is especially habitual, remaining long after speech forms have changed, as we readily observe in English words like night, nat, or name. In fact, Bloomfield points out that once a system of spelling has become antiquated in relation to the spoken sounds, learned scribes are likely to invent pseudo-archaic spellings. So, for example, the spelling with B in loanwords like debt, doubt, and subtle does not derive from Old French, but rather was created by learned scribes who knew the Latin antecedents debitum, dubito, and subtilis. The changes in spelling, lexicon, and even grammar tend to be instigated by historical and ideological developments, and not simply by the constant change in speech forms. The problem of writing as a surrogate for language begins with the inadequacy of writing itself, namely, the problem of representing sounds with letters. Or, to use technical jargon, the graphemic inventory, that is, the letters of Hebrew, are an imprecise representation of the phonemic inventory, that is, the sounds, of the classical Hebrew language. The 22-letter Hebrew alphabet was borrowed from Phoenician, which seems to have had a more limited inventory of phonemes than Hebrew. Furthermore, the Phoenician alphabet did not represent vowels, and this creates its own problems. As far as the consonantal graphemes are concerned, we know that Hebrew had at least 25 consonantal phonemes, that is, sounds, and that certain graphemes had to serve from multiple phonemes. So, for example, the letter ayin in the Phoenician alphabet had to serve double duty for both, and g, and the letter chet serves for both h and h. Likewise, the letter shim served for both s and s, and many centuries passed before the Masoretic system introduced a dot to distinguish between the two, and even these 25 consonants had to be an oversimplification of the phonemes of classical Hebrew. Spoken language naturally reflects a more fluid development between sounds, whereas the written language tends to be more static in its development. Often a significant gap develops between the written text that is prescribed by tradition, schools, and government, and the spoken vernacular. In his critique of Biblical Hebrew as a language, Ollendorf further noted the deficiency of the consonantal skeleton of the Bible. The system of writing ancient Hebrew is largely consonantal, even though vowel letters were introduced by the late 8th century BCE. The elaborate system of sublinear vowel letters, as well as accents, was only introduced by the Masoretes around the 7th century CE. Although an increasingly developed use of vowel letters was introduced in ancient Israel and flourished in the Dead Sea Scrolls as well as rabbinic manuscripts, these vowel letters were still limited notations of the spoken language. Indeed, the Masoretic vocalizations of the Book of Isaiah certainly did not represent the way the prophet Isaiah would have spoken Hebrew. Rather, they represented a stylized liturgical tradition of reading that developed within the Jewish community. Ferdinand de Saussure, 1857-1913, the acknowledged father of modern linguistics, called attention to the arbitrariness of linguistic signs, that is, written language. Saussure also called attention to the primary nature of the oral speech that underpins all verbal communication, criticizing the tendency to approach language primarily through its written manifestation. According to Saussure, writing is the complement to oral speech. Along the guidelines set forth by Saussure, linguistics developed primarily according to oral categories as a study of phonemics. To some extent, Saussure may be indirectly responsible for the focus in classical Hebrew studies on phonology and morphology. For Hebrew, we would say that its writing was arbitrarily created and perpetuated in scribal schools. We should be clear, however, what we mean by schools. The system of scribal training was largely an apprentice system, which was not open to all classes of society. The early history of Hebrew, then, would be a history of the scribal schools and the institutions that supported them. In ancient societies, especially those without alphabetic writing, for example, Egyptian hieroglyphs or Mesopotamian cuneiform, the relationship between speech and written symbols was at best approximate. Even after the invention of the alphabet, the invention of only consonants without vowels makes the relationship between speech and writing imprecise. The situation is much more complicated among other Levantine cultures that adopted the Phoenician consonantal alphabet, even though they had different and fuller phonetic inventories. This is somewhat analogous to cuneiform writing, where the writing system was invented by the Sumerians and borrowed for the Akkadian language, even though Sumerian is an Indo-European language and Akkadian is Semitic. This observation does not even begin to take into consideration the conservative nature of the written linguistic code in representing the more fluid oral linguistic code. This problem is amply illustrated for anyone who is trying to explain to a 6-year-old why the English word spelled night is pronounced Nate. In short, letters greatly oversimplify sounds. This observation makes us quite sanguine about the nature of our investigation of the Hebrew language. A sociolinguistic approach. The present study takes a sociolinguistic approach to the history of the Hebrew language. Simply put, sociolinguistics is the study of the relationship between language and society. It utilizes the tools and methods of the fields of linguistics and social theory. The discipline of sociolinguistics has grown immensely over the past few decades, and this has included the development of the field of anthropological linguistics. Although anthropological linguistics is sometimes separated from sociolinguistics, I regard them as related fields and would use the terms interchangeably. There seems to be a general tendency for American scholars to prefer the term anthropological linguistics, whereas European scholars use the term sociolinguistics. A critical premise of sociolinguistics is that language is part of a cultural system. Language does not exist in a vacuum. For example, sociolinguists argue that attitudes to language clearly play an important role in preserving or removing dialect differences. The noted linguist William Lebov actually objected to the term sociolinguistics because he argued that language is a social behavior, thus rendering the term sociolinguistics redundant and misleading. Language is used in social contexts for communicating needs, ideas, and emotions. Lebov argued that the study of languages can never be conducted separately from their social contexts. He suggested that a different phrase, the sociology of language, be used to refer to the interaction of large-scale social factors like dialect and language interaction, language planning, nationalism, and language or standardization of language. The present study will be more concerned with what Lebov called the sociology of language. In spite of Lebov's objections, however, the term sociolinguistics has come to be used to describe a wide variety of the social aspects of language. Though the discipline of sociolinguistics has developed especially in the last few decades, the social aspect of language has long been acknowledged in the academic study of linguistics. For example, Ferdinand de Saussure began his course in general linguistics with the premise that language is a social institution. Saussure argued that language has both an individual and a social aspect, and that one is not conceivable without the other. It was not entirely novel for Saussure to claim that language is a social phenomenon. This view was influenced by Enlightenment thinkers such as the English philosophers Thomas Hobbes and John Locke, the German philosopher Johann Gottfried von Herder, and the French sociologist Émile Durkheim, to name only a few. Their influence was particularly strong in Saussure's understanding of language as a social institution. The studies of Franz Boas, Edward Sapir, and Benjamin Whorf added an anthropological approach to the study of language. Coming from the field of anthropology, they studied Native American peoples and their languages, and they argued that the grammar of a particular language shapes the way we think about reality. Indeed, this approach received a boost from the remarkable diversity of Native American languages. Boas, for instance, suggested that languages classify experience and that these linguistic classifications reflect rather than dictate culture. Sapper defined language as a purely human and non-instinctive method of communicating ideas, emotions, and desires by means of a system of voluntarily produced symbols. Worf, although he acknowledged that culture might influence language, emphasized that it was through individuals and their habitual worlds that language exerts pressure on the culture as a whole. Although the stronger, deterministic version of the Sapper-Whorf linguistic relativity hypothesis, namely, that language determines thought, is no longer acceptable, scholars acknowledge that language and culture do move along parallel lines, even if the exact relationship is difficult to prove. The modern study of language has also been shaped by the neo-grammarian revolution in the late 19th century. Neo-grammarians argued that the principles or laws of language change could be analyzed accurately and completely once all the assembled facts were known. Laws regarding the regularity of sound change, such as Grimm's Law, would then apply in all cases. The lure of the immutable neo-grammarian scientific laws has exerted continuing influence. It is noteworthy that neo-grammarian rules theoretically applied to spoken language, not to written language. Equally important has been the descriptive approach associated with Leonard Bloomfield. Bloomfield himself was trained in the neo-grammarian tradition, but his methodology was particularly influenced by his own fieldwork describing Native American languages. Though Bloomfield recognized the importance of the historical or diachronic aspect of language study, his own work focused on the synchronic description of language. Bloomfield argued that all historical study of language change or comparative study of languages was grounded in descriptive data. He allowed for no influence of society upon language, in part because his view was predominantly synchronic and contemporary. Nevertheless, the historical aspect of language or language change plays a minor role in his seminal work on language. Indeed, William LeBove argued that one cannot make any major advance towards understanding the mechanism of linguistic change without serious study of the social factors which motivate linguistic evolution. Recent trends in linguistics have emphasized the social function of language. This has developed into a field of its own, functional linguistics, which has blossomed over the past decades in an almost bewildering display of color and variety. Socio and functional linguistics have in common the premise that language arises from the human need to communicate, as opposed to the notion that language arises from man's need to express himself. Most linguists do not deal with social life at all. The linguistic anthropologist Paul Croscritti points to two neglected forces, the linguistic awareness of speakers and the non-referential functions of language. Both of these forces were prematurely marginalized by the dominant and disciplinarily institutionalized approaches to language, which denied the relevance, to linguistics, certainly, of a speaker's own linguistic analysis and valorized the referential functions of language to the exclusion of others. In effect, this surgical removal of language from context produced an amputated language that was the preferred object of the language sciences for most of the 20th century. As the British sociolinguist Suzanne Romaine notes, modern linguistics has generally taken for granted that grammars are unrelated to the social lives of their speakers. At the same time, sociologists have tended to treat society as if it could be constituted without language. The term sociolinguistics, referring to the study of the relationship between language and society, was only coined in the 1950s, and the discipline is still young. It can hardly be surprising that sociolinguistics has yet to have an impact on the study of classical Hebrew. Even in ancient Israel, language was a social marker linked with identity. The sociolinguist André Tabaret Keller notes, "The language spoken by somebody and his or her identity as a speaker of this language are inseparable." This is surely a piece of knowledge as old as human speech itself. This truism can be readily illustrated by an example that we have already discussed, namely, the Shibboleth-Sibboleth episode in Judges chapter 12 verses 5 to 6. Although the problem of how exactly the Gileadite and Ephraimite dialects differed is still a matter of debate, in part because of the imprecision of the graphemes, the commonplace sociolinguistic observation that language and linguistic forms can index social groups is played out. Traditional linguistic approaches to this text have endlessly debated the precise pronunciation of the sibilants, yet the real linguistic import of the text is sociolinguistic. It tells us, for instance, that language is a social boundary. Even among the Israelite tribes, linguistic distinctions were recognized and served as social markers. Seth Schwartz has observed that stories like the Book of Ruth assume that Judahites and Moabites spoke mutually comprehensible languages. Yet just because languages or dialects are mutually intelligible does not mean that they do not index group identity. For example, a Canadian can distinguish himself from an American by the pronunciation of a few words, such as about or schedule, or by the use of a as the marker of a question. These are small but important markers of linguistic identity that are not merely modern, as we see in a story such as Judges chapter 12. On the basis of language, we distinguish homelands in national and political affiliations, as well as social class. In the words of the fictional character Henry Higgins, an Englishman's way of speaking absolutely classifies him. To change our identity, we try to change the way we speak. This is to say, language change can be socially loaded. The study of classical Hebrew. It should hardly be surprising that the diachronic study of classical Hebrew in its social context is relatively undeveloped territory. Indeed, a little more than two decades ago, Lebov described the study of language change in its social context as a virgin field. Since then, some scholars have begun to plow this field, but little work has been done to cultivate it specifically for classical Hebrew. The tradition of the field of Semitic linguistics and Hebrew, in particular, has followed a descriptive and neo-Grammarian orientation, with its emphasis on morphology and phonology. This is perhaps best illustrated by the fact that the classic grammar of Hebrew by Jesenius Koch and Cowley gives almost no attention to syntax. The grammars of Juon and Brockelman are only slightly better. The recent grammar by Waltke and O'Connor also focuses primarily on morphology and phonology, in spite of its promising title, An Introduction to Biblical Hebrew Syntax. A quick perusal of the main historical grammars and histories of the Hebrew language will not turn up anything like a prolegomenon to the study of language. One exception to this might be the somewhat neglected study of Zelig Harris, the development of the Canaanite dialects. The study of Hebrew, especially classical Hebrew, has been quite conventional. And conventional means that the traditional grammars and histories of Hebrew have been neo-Grammarian and descriptive. As early as the 1950s, Chaim Rabin wrote an article on the social background of Qumran Hebrew. In the 1970s, he published a very short book entitled A Short History of the Hebrew Language, which was expressly concerned with the relationship between language and Jewish social life. And his now standard article on the emergence of classical Hebrew gives a decidedly socio-historical interpretation. Rabin's work reflected his broad training in linguistics and his interest in practical fields like translation theory. Although Rabin's articles on the emergence of classical Hebrew and on Qumran Hebrew have been well received, his sociolinguistic history of Hebrew is relatively unknown. Several other authors have addressed quite limited issues that would fall into the purview of sociolinguistics. The classic work of Harris was concerned with the linguistic conditions in Syria-Palestine, as these shaped the structure of the Canaanite languages. The important recent work of Randall Garr employs a thoroughgoing descriptive approach in mapping a dialect geography of Syria-Palestine. This forms a foundation for any sociolinguistic analysis. Gary Rendsburg's revised dissertation, published in 1990 under the title Diglossia in Ancient Hebrew, points to 12 grammatical features that he considers colloquial. He points out that these features become especially prominent in LBH, but that they also appear in SBH. He reasons that the dialect that later emerged as MH was already in use in the early biblical period too. Relying on Rabin's analysis of the emergence of biblical Hebrew, Rendsburg notes recent trends in linguistics that emphasize the effect that political and social change may have on a language. The subject, unfortunately, is dropped there. Rendsburg's more recent work focusing on dialect geography and the history of Hebrew is not explicitly sociolinguistic, yet his work nevertheless touches on sociolinguistic issues time and again. Perhaps the most extensive foray into the social groups behind the Hebrew language is Ian Young's Diversity in Pre-Exilic Hebrew. Young eschews the traditional approach that tends to minimize linguistic diversity in order to create a standard biblical grammar. He argues that orthodox scholarship, as he calls it, relies too heavily on chronological explanations to account for the linguistic diversity in biblical Hebrew. According to Young, the diversity of pre-exilic Hebrew begins with the social diversity of the Israelite tribes themselves. He points to the impact of social forces on the linguistic evolution of pre-exilic Hebrew. The United Monarchy, for example, becomes the catalyst for a standardization of Hebrew. Young's work is an important first step. He collects and analyzes many of the possible types of pre-exilic Hebrew and ascribes a variety of social settings to account for diversity. As I hope this work shall make clear, his work can be developed further in three important respects. First, there is little use of sociolinguistics or anthropological linguistics to inform his social analyses. As Leboeuf pointed out, the forces operating to produce linguistic change today are the same kind and order of magnitude as those which operated in the past 5 or 10,000 years. This observation certainly invites broader interdisciplinary reflection on language diversity and change. Second, contributions from archaeology create a more nuanced understanding of the historical forces that shape the evolution of classical Hebrew. Without a clear idea of the social forces at work, it is impossible to draw proper conclusions about the evolution of the Hebrew language. Finally, Young relies too heavily on assumptions about linguistic diversity generated by spoken languages, whereas biblical Hebrew is a literary language, and its written linguistic forms were formulated in scribal schools. For these reasons, Young's emphasis on synchronic linguistic diversity seems overstated. One way to describe the field of classical Hebrew would be formalist. By this we mean that classical Hebrew has often been treated as though the essential nature of Hebrew is intrinsic. The Hebrew language has been studied in isolation from other external forces, most notably sociological forces. We may further illustrate the problem by analogy to the related field of literature. I.R.T. Tunick explains the formalist position in literary theory. Literature was an extrasocial phenomenon, or rather, that which constituted the literariness of literature, its specificity, was something self-valuable, self-contained, and self-perpetuating that should and must be isolated from the social surrounding in which it existed in order to be made an object of knowledge, that while social forces and events could, and did sometimes even drastically, affect literature from the outside, the real, intrinsic nature of literature remained immune, exclusively and forever true to itself alone, that therefore proper and productive study of literature is possible only in immanent terms. By substituting language for literature, we encapsulate a formalist approach to Hebrew that steers clear of social explanations. Indeed, one finds only occasional mention of social forces in traditional grammars. It is recognized, for instance, that the enormous influence that Aramaic exerted on Hebrew began with socio-historical.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.